Good morning and welcome to our 15th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2024. I've received no apologies for this meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are members agreed?
Yeah.
Thank you. The second item on our agenda is an evidence session with Dr. Hilary Cass concerning her review of gender identity services for children and young people commissioned by NHS England. And Dr. Cass is joining us remotely, and I welcome her to the committee. She was the chair of the Cass review. And we will move straight to questions, Dr. Cass. Thank you for your time. And I'll go to Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Dr. Cass. Thank you for being with us this morning. Your review is obviously a really detailed piece of work that needs careful consideration. I think we all appreciate that it was based on services in England, but will have implications for how children are treated in Scotland as well, and there's learning for us all within that. I wonder if you could start off by talking about the sort of key conclusions that you would want us here in Scotland to draw from this work in order to do the best for children in distress.
Yes, so I think as will be clear from the report, the main issue of concern for me was the weakness of the evidence base. And that's across all aspects of care. So critically, we need to work collaboratively as broadly as we can, both nationally and internationally, to try and improve that evidence base. And the second piece of learning from England was that firstly, children were being bypassed because they were not getting basic assessments locally. Often they were bypassed straight through to the GID service at Tavistock. But crucially, and I think this is transferable, these young people need a very broad multidisciplinary approach to care because they often have complex presentations, and just seeing them through a gender lens means that they don't get the breadth of care that they need. So I think those are the two messages that apply, you know, regardless of where in the UK or internationally you are.
Thank you, that's helpful. That's fine, Janine. Can you?
Thank you. Tess White.
Thank you. Good morning, Dr. Cass. In relation to the 32 recommendations from a very comprehensive report, is there anything specific in relation to the delivery of services that you believe could apply in a Scottish context? Thank you.
Yes, so I think some of the things that I just alluded to, I mean, particularly in England, we are embedding these services within a broader children's hospital service setting so that there is access to services for young people with autism, with eating disorders, with a range of other presentations, so that they do get looked at holistically. And also, I think both the research and the clinical approach, which is going to be regionalised, should the Scottish Government and Health Service feel that it was helpful, there is scope both to include Scotland within the research infrastructure that we're setting up in England, and also within the regional network where there's the ability to share and support clinical practice. But clearly that's a decision to be made in Scotland. It's certainly something that I think we would welcome in England.
Thank you. My second question, if I may. So you, in your opening, and to answer Ruth Maguire's question, you talked about the importance of evidence base and collaboration. A question about how do you feel that certain factions of the Scottish Green Party have actually said that your work is a social murder charter?
I think it's not for me to comment on any political opinion in Scotland. I think my job is to just comment on the evidence as I see it. But if that were to be framed into specific questions or concerns about my conclusions or the work, I'd be happy to answer them.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Dr. Cass, can I ask what key conclusions would you want practitioners in Scotland to draw from the review in terms of future provision for gender services?
So I think it's important that young people get a holistic assessment, and that includes looking at all aspects of their presentation and trying to understand the gender questioning in the context of other issues that are happening for them. So one of the problems in just focusing on the gender is, you know, that you can end up giving somebody putting somebody on an endocrine pathway when you haven't addressed the fact that they have undiagnosed autism, they're out of school, they're not participating, there's family breakdown and all those other factors. So I think it's, you know, seeing them as a young person first and understanding the gender distress through that lens. And I think accepting that two things are simultaneously true. Firstly, that a small number of these young people are going to benefit from a medical pathway for their gender distress, but that equally for probably a larger number, their gender distress is going to be resolved in myriad other ways, whether that is this has been a sort of developmental questioning period that spontaneously resolves, or whether they resolve uncertainty about their sexuality and then their gender questioning resolves, or, you know, whether they find that they don't want a very rigid medical pathway but just remain gender fluid or gender non-conforming in the longer term. So I think it's about being open and exploring and making sure that options aren't foreclosed too soon for that young person. I think that's probably the single most important takeaway.
Thank you. Thank you for that answer. Ivan McKee.
Thank you. Good morning, Dr. Cass, and thank you for spending some time with us this morning. You've rightly mentioned that the evidence base is a hugely important part of the work that you've undertaken, and clearly that's gained a bit of traction in the discourse following your report. So it'd be good to give you the opportunity just to talk through the approach that was taken in assessing that evidence in terms of the systematic review methodology and what evidence was included and what wasn't included as part of that, that assessment and why. Thank you.
Yes, so the systematic reviews were carried out by the University of York, which was one of a small number of organisations that are commissioned by the NHS to carry out systematic reviews. It was overseen by the head of that department. They looked at a very wide array of papers, well in excess of 200 across all areas, but the papers that have got most attention are the ones that have focused on puberty blockers and masculinizing and feminizing hormones, and there were 102 papers that were included within that search. There's been significant misinformation about those, and I hope that's now corrected in everyone's minds. But just to be clear, there was an incorrect piece of information being circulated that the 98% of those papers had been disregarded and that only randomised control trials were included. Both of those things are wrong. There were no randomised controlled trials, but there were still two high quality papers and some 50 moderate quality papers. So overall, 58%. Something over 50, but anyway, 58% of the 102 papers were included within the analysis because they were high or moderate quality. Those papers included a whole variety of different studies, mainly what's called cohort studies, where you follow up and compare groups or look longitudinally, and they're not randomised controlled trials, but they're still accepted as good evidence if they're conducted well. The significant weaknesses in most of the literature were that, the significant weaknesses was that the follow-up periods were not long enough, that there was significant loss to follow-up, so you started off with a larger sample, and because significant numbers fell out during the course of the study, it just made it hard to draw conclusions, that the comparison groups weren't appropriate. So it was a very poor literature compared to most other literature, including in children's healthcare practice. So that was quite striking. And the evidence for the efficacy of both puberty blockers and masculinizing and feminizing hormones was weak, and we are still unclear about potential adverse effects. If the committee wants, I can say a bit more about puberty blockers, because that's been a source of contention, I know.
Yeah, I think we'll come on to that in follow-up questions. Thanks very much. So that's great, because you've kind of answered some of my supplementary questions as well. So it's true to say that this supposed statistic of 96 or 98% of the evidence being ignored is A, wrong, and B, the evidence that wasn't included, which sounds to be a bit less than half of it, wasn't included because it wasn't a robust enough methodological approach to be included in the work that York University carried out. That's good. And then the other point I was going to ask about was, how does this compare to methodologies as applied in other areas of paediatric medicine? But I think you've answered that by saying it significantly falls short of what you would see in other areas. I wanted to move on and just ask you about how do we fill those gaps? So what research is underway at the moment? Is it sufficient? What else needs to be done? How long is it going to take for us to build up an evidence base that allows us to address these questions more robustly?
Yes, absolutely on the last question, just to say, there has been the question of, have we set a higher bar for this research, for this systematic review? And we absolutely haven't. I think, in terms of the bar we should set, these young people should get the same standard of evidence in their care as every other young person. So just to say that. So where we are in England, there is a puberty blocker trial being designed that will have obviously involvement from service users, but the lead investigator has been appointed, and a group has started to come together to think about that. There is potentially going to be some international collaboration on that. But I feel that we really need every young person who walks through the door, ideally to agree to be part of some kind of study and follow up, because it is just important for us to understand what happens to the young people who do not go on a medical pathway as those who do, understand what aspects of care, both medical and non-medical, were helpful for the whole group. And that does mean following young people up into adulthood, including those who go on a on a medical pathway. Obviously, we can't compel anybody to be followed up into adulthood, and a lot of that is about rebuilding trust with young people, so that they wish to be part of a study into adulthood to help the young people coming behind them.
That's great, thank you. And just to be clear, what questions would you hope that the research and future evidence would give us the answers to?
Yeah, so we want to understand if there is a small group of young people who do benefit from puberty blockers. We also want to understand what the any potential negative effects there might be on that, particularly for broader brain development and psychosexual, psychosocial development, and bone health and other physical health indicators. And we want to understand more about which young people may benefit in the longer term for going on to a masculinizing or feminizing hormones. I mean, the real challenge is that young people's sense of self and gender identity continues to evolve into young adulthood, and it's we don't have an accurate way of predicting who will have a long-term stable trans identity. And so the more we're able to be really clear about who has a successful long-term outcome and who has an outcome that doesn't meet their aspirations, the better that will be. And we also need to understand what are the things that matter in the longer term to those young people. So it's not just about can you successfully achieve a sort of medical transition? We know that we can do that, but are people in the longer term are they participating? Do they have a job? Do they have a partner? Are they happy with their sex life? Are they happy are they psychologically well? All of those things are important.
So that would be looking at physical and mental outcomes from a health perspective.
And social outcomes, yeah.
And social, and that would obviously also look at people that chose to detransition at a future stage as well.
Yes, and I think there's been anxiety about, looking at, the trans community has been concerned that we're looking at detransitioners to say we shouldn't be giving gender-affirming care. I think the important thing about understanding about people who do detransition is what were the factors that led them to detransition? Were there earlier signs that this may not have been a successful pathway for them? And those are things that you can then build into the equation that you discuss with somebody coming through, so that they know, what the likely risks are for them as an individual. It's the same as any medical intervention where you look at somebody who has a less successful outcome. You then explain that to people who want to undergo that same procedure to inform them. That's not telling them they can't do it. It's saying these are the risks that we're aware of.
That's great. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
Thank you. Thank you, convener. Good morning, Dr. Cass. Thank you for being here this morning. I'm interested to hear about one of the recommendations about how young people should remain within a service from the age of 17 to 25. The recommendation says that NHS England should ensure that each regional centre has a follow-through service for 17 to 25-year-olds, either by extending the range of the regional children and young people service or through linked services. So I'm interested to hear about how that recommendation means that these young people should stay under the care between the age of 17 to 25, and how would that work in practice? Because I think there has been some misrepresentation that says that that means no one will be able to transition before that age.
Yes. So, yes, there's been a lot of misunderstanding about this recommendation as well, as you rightly say. So the reason we propose this, it's in line with other service, other aspirations that NHS England has for longer term services for young people, both mental health, cancer, And it's about continuity of care. So the worst possible time, in a way, to transfer services is when you're at a critical point in your gender transition around 17 to 18. And we know that that's been a high risk time when young people get lost between the children's and adult service. There are problems in managing their medication through that period, and switching care providers is challenging. It is also a time when we lose data, which is important if we're trying to get better long-term data. So the idea is to provide continuity through for those young people who are already in the service. It doesn't, so if you are already over 18 when you get referred, you would still get referred to existing services. You wouldn't come through that service. At the moment, it's specifically being set up to take people who have started through when they were younger, to give that continuity of clinical care and also follow-up data.
And just to pick up on what you said about misrepresenting what was either in this recommendation or other parts of the report, you earlier talked about a holistic assessment for young people, for the whole process. And one of the comments we have is that this recommendation is based on dubious science. So it's just to pick up on the, to I suppose, solidify the advice or the recommendation that you've put forward around a whole process for young people right up until the age of 25.
So, the bit that you think is that has been said to be based on dubious science is having a holistic assessment.
No, well, really about the whole part of the whole wider recommendation about helping support young people right through the whole process. The information that we have here says it was based on dubious science. So I'd be interested to hear how. Is that one of the misrepresentations of the report?
So I think the misrepresentation was that we said that that young people would not have to transition at this vulnerable time between, meaning transition between services. And it was taken to mean that they wouldn't have to transition, meaning a gender transition, at this vulnerable time, and that was a misreading, because the term transition is used to describe the move from children's to adult care as well as gender transition, and it was taken to mean we were saying that children should not go through a gender transition at that time. That wasn't what we were saying, I think it came under the heading about transition, and a section headed transition, service transition. So that was a misreading. I don't know whether that helps.
It does help, actually, the power of the correct words. So, yes, thank you.
Yeah. We'll now move to Sandesh Kulhani.
Thank you, Convener, and Declaration of Interest as a practicing NHS GP. Thank you for joining us, Dr. Cass. I have grave concerns over the use of puberty blockers for children, given the paucity of evidence. And the early intervention study did not demonstrate benefit. And I do feel that ideology and dogma has no place in medical treatment. So given that you stated young people's gender identity is fluid with no hierarchy, do you feel there is a point of age where it becomes more fixed?
There was a study released around the time that the report was in press, which showed that gender discontentedness was relatively high from age 11, and it continued to drop sequentially into early 20s. So it's really, really difficult to know when exactly the sweet spot is, when somebody's not going to be, when somebody's gender identity is not going to be continuing to change, and when's the best time to commence an irreversible treatment. I think the thing that we were quite struck by was young adults who we spoke to as part of the engagement process and also through our qualitative research. They said that they wished they'd known there were more ways to be trans than just a binary medical transition. And you can be more fluid. You don't necessarily have to go down a medical pathway, although some will. And their main advice to their younger self would be, you know, it's not urgent. You don't have to rush, although they said it feels urgent. And their younger self probably wouldn't have taken too much notice of their older self. So that's the dilemma that we all face.
I mean, certainly the things I believed when I was a child is very different to the things that I believe now and what I feel is important and not. But recommendation 8 in your report states that we should be looking to prescribe medication at 18, with your recommendation 6 stating that we need a trial. And so I suppose, you know, my question is, if it is given below the age of 18, do you feel that there is a point where, or if it's appropriate that this could happen without parents' knowledge, or do you feel that 18 is the point? And also, given your last statement, why did recommendation 8 say 18?
So largely because we don't have, my remit doesn't extend beyond 18, and 18, a young person is considered to have capacity at 16 unless we have good reason to think that they don't. So it is hard to make a legal distinction between a 16 and 18 year old in terms of capacity. When I thought about consent, the challenge is not so much about capacity, but the other elements of it, which is the clinical judgment to offer a treatment, which, as you know, we all bear responsibility for treatments that we offer, and knowing whether that is the right treatment for that individual. And secondly, the information that we give to inform consent about the risks and benefits, which again is weak. So you know, legal cases have obviously focused on competence and capacity, but you know, those are the other challenges, those other two pillars of knowing whether we're giving the right treatment to the right people.
I mean, certainly GILLET competence can be from 13 onwards, and that's why I was asking about parents as well. So do you feel that we are able to use GILLET competence in this treatment pathway? And if we can, should the parents be aware?
So the Tavistock avoided treating without parental consent and engagement, and everything we know about outcomes in young people is that they thrive better with family support. So I think I would have severe reservations about any child who was put on this kind of pathway without a competent adult supporting that decision. The Dutch protocol, which the Tavistock was supposed to be adhering to in its service spec, specified parental support and for the decision. So I think that should stand.
Thank you. I have also got real concerns about private treatment. Throughout your report, you talk about an MDT approach, multidisciplinary team approach. And in fact, that is your recommendation 9. So should a single private practitioner be prescribing medication, and is it appropriate for this to occur?
I have really deep concerns, like you, about private provision. By de facto, based on the recommendations we have made, that will not be meeting this standard, and I feel that that does put young people at considerable risk to not have the level of assessment that we're describing.
Thank you. My final question, if I may, Dr. Cass. Regret and detransitioning is an important area. And what has your research shown, or has it been able to show, how many children experience regret? And seeing as you've said that puberty blockers are irreversible, what do we then do with children who do face that issue?
OK, so the bit that's irreversible, that we know to be irreversible, is some of the effects of the masculinizing and feminizing hormones. we don't know the percentage that detransition or regret. Largely because the follow-up has not been long enough, and also because those who do detransition or regret don't necessarily come back to the NHS, and they frequently... Sorry, excuse me, I don't know, I've got a frog in my throat this morning. They often don't come back to the clinic that they originated from. So that is a significant problem. But I think it's more subtle than that, because, for example, I spoke to a young adult who started transition very early, male to female. She's doing well. She had puberty blockers at the earliest stage. She had feminizing hormones at the earliest stage, and she passes very well as a woman. But with hindsight, she knows she was a boy with intense internalized homophobia and was gay. But at this point in her life, she's clearly not going to detransition, so she wouldn't show up in regret or detransition data, but thinks that maybe this was not the right decision to have made. There will be people who are living a good life, but may, with hindsight, have made a different decision, and that's much, much more subtle. There are also people who are living their best life, having gone through a medical transition, and for them, the costs and side effects of treatment, are worthwhile compared to what it would have been like to have to live their life within their birth registered gender. So, you know, those sort of subtleties are really difficult for us to get under the skin of.
Thank you.
Thank you. We'll move to Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Dr. Cass. Do you believe, and does your research show, that puberty blockers or gender-affirming hormones could be the right intervention for some children or young people?
Yes, we think that certainly masculinizing and feminizing hormones could be the right treatment. We don't know which young people those are. Puberty blockers, it's much less clear what the indication is. I'm not sure whether the chair would like me to just say something about what we do and don't know about puberty blockers and what the various indications.
Yep. Yes, please.
Yeah. So the starting position as to why puberty blockers were introduced, because previously you wouldn't start on a medical pathway until you were 16 plus. And this was because the adult consultants who moved into the Dutch clinic had seen poor outcomes in adult patients and felt that one of the reasons is that they weren't passing, that was having adverse psychological effects. So she reasoned that if you blocked puberty from early, you wouldn't get particularly the irreversible pubertal changes that birth registered males get, where you will get facial hair and drop your voice and so on, and that will always make it hard for you to pass. And the second thing she reasoned was that it would buy time to think. So going through those indications, there is no evidence that it buys time to think in that the vast majority of those who go on to puberty blockers do then go on to masculinizing and feminizing hormones. So it may be that it is altering the trajectory and making it less likely that once you start, you will reconsider the options because you haven't gone through your own puberty, you haven't gone through that psychosexual development pathway. The other aspects that have been looked at is, does it improve your body image? Does it make you less dysphoric? And nobody, not even the original Dutch study, showed that to be the case. And then the other thing is, does it improve your psychological well-being? And although the original Dutch study found some weak evidence of that, the English study did not replicate that. No other study has really replicated that. So that leaves us with one specific indication, is that they may be helpful, particularly for birth registered boys, birth registered males, to prevent those irreversible changes. But one of the downsides of this focus on puberty blockers, which have become almost totemic for being the way to get on to a treatment pathway, is it stopped us looking at other ways of managing young people's distress during that time when they're working out what the right pathway is for them. And so we haven't looked at known evidence-based treatments for anxiety and depression, such as psychological support or even, medications for anxiety and depression that may be just as effective for, or more effective than puberty blockers. I don't know if that all makes sense. So it's being really clear about what they're for and for whom.
That's great, thank you. A range of trans organisations and people have said that the report recommendations and the narrative surrounding it give the impression that transition would be the worst outcome for a young person. How would you respond to those who get that impression from the report?
Yes, so for somebody who is going to have an enduring long-term trans identity, medical transition is a really important option, and one from which many people do benefit. The risk of starting that transition at a time when somebody is still developmentally labile, is still in the process of development, is that you give the treatment to the wrong group of people. And the reason that is a negative outcome is because medical transition does not come without costs in terms of effect on sexual function, fertility, our knowns and unknowns about long-term bone health risk, the limitations of surgery. All of those things are costs which are well worthwhile if you have a long-term stable trans identity, but it's a high cost to pay if in the longer term you don't. And so picking that sweet point where, as I said, where you have a high level of certainty that you're giving the treatment to the right people is very important. And the group that we have least understanding about is the group that we are most commonly seeing now in clinic, which is birth registered females who are presenting in adolescence, for whom there may be a range of other factors driving their gender-related distress.
That's great, thank you. And just one final question. You mentioned earlier in other answers about research. What does good research in your view look like in this area? And do you think it's important that trans and non-binary people are involved in all stages in co-producing that research?
So the answer to the second question is straightforward, yes, and that's clearly built into any research and will be built into this. But we need well-designed studies with adequate follow-up and with really clear comparisons with other kinds of treatment options. And that's what's been lacking from previous research. So the team is thinking already about the most ethical and acceptable ways to do that, and there will be very careful engagement with service users.
That's great. Thanks, Convener.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you to Dr. Cass for your contribution so far. I just wanted to look at the wider balance of harms in this area. We've noted the average wait for referral to gender, or from referral to seeing someone at a gender dysphoria clinic, can often be over 4 years. And in that time, there may be, you know, significant distress, physical, psychological, social, and that may include self-medicating, you know, with hormone replacement drugs. I'm not sure about puberty blockers, how accessible they are. And obviously that can introduce unregulated harms beyond, say, the practice of bridging prescriptions. So I just wondered if you could maybe comment more on what observations, what evidence you've been able to see about that broader practice or behaviour of self-medication.
Yes, I mean, we haven't had any way of systematically understanding how much that's going on, but clearly it's happening, you know, way more than we would wish. I think, as we all understand, the thing that is driving this is major shortfalls in children's mental health services. So young people are in a state of distress and anxiety. They are not getting any support for that or any other aspect of their presenting problem often. And they only have available advice from the internet or from peer support groups. And so it's inevitable that they're going to, you know, take what we would deem as higher risk actions. And I can understand that because, you know, they're often in a situation where the care provided by the health system is failing them. And that's a system failure that's related to, you know, workforce and all sorts of things. But I think, you know, there is another big problem, which is fearfulness amongst healthcare practitioners. So these young people are more disadvantaged than other similarly distressed young people, certainly in England, because people have been bypassing them. Somebody comes and says they're gender questioning, and health professionals feel nervous because they don't think they've got the skills. They're worried about the toxicity of the debate. They're worried about doing or saying the wrong thing. So they pass them straight through to the JIDS waiting list. And, you know, the areas that they would have been able to manage because they've got all the skills to do so don't get treated.
Okay. Do you have any thoughts about how best to remedy that?
I think it's starting already in the new centres in England, in that now that practitioners have started seeing young people, they're really clear that these are the same young people that they're seeing in other clinics. You know, there's a, you know, because, you know, there's been concern about starting that new service. And I think it's about building confidence. I mean, when I was registrar for the Royal College of Paediatrics and Child Health some 15 plus years ago, we were really worried that we weren't going to be able to recruit paediatricians because they were so scared about safeguarding. And you were in a situation where it was catastrophic if you made an error in either direction, overdiagnosed or underdiagnosed. the research was poor, there were no guidelines, and there was very little training. And the way we remedied that was with much better research, much better guidance, and really clear training and supervision. And that turned it round, and it became an interesting area of practice. And that's what we want to achieve here. A lot of it is about building confidence, because professionals do have the transferable skills, and they just need to know that these are the same young people with the same hopes and aspirations and anxieties as, you know, most of the rest of the people in their clinic.
Can I just pick up on a point there, Dr. Cass, in a response to Paul Sweeney, and he was asking about unregulated access to hormonal treatment or to puberty blockers. Was I correct in picking you up saying that it's happening way more than we would wish, that children and young people are accessing those medications in an unregulated way? Okay, thank you. It was for a point of clarity. Thank you. Ivan McKee.
I think I've covered all the issues on research follow-up when I did the earlier questions.
Can we move to Carol Mullen?
Thank you, Dr. Cass. I want to just explore, if you don't mind, a couple of questions around the approaches to gender care and young people, and the move, perhaps you described it as the model, the dominant model of sort of gender affirming. And you talked about clinicians feeling pressure to simply affirm children, and that could lead to diagnostic overshadowing. For example, you've touched on mental health issues and they've been missed. So I suppose my first question is how do you think a conversion therapy ban would affect that situation, and could you advise how we might go forward with that to ensure that we do give children that protected time to look at this issue?
Yes, this one's a big challenge, and all I can say is I'm glad I'm a doctor and not a litigator, because it is a really difficult problem. You know, everyone should be protected from conversion therapy. It's a completely unacceptable practice. But the challenge of, because thinking about the legislation, the issue has been about intent. And if a therapist engages with a young person and they change their views about their gender identity during the course of that therapeutic relationship, and then they subsequently say it was because the therapist had an intent to change their gender identity, that puts the therapist in a difficult position, because how can you legally determine in intent, and that anxiety that you may be the test case is making clinicians even more anxious potentially about working in this area, and we don't want to do anything to frighten professionals off from working in this. So walking that path is very difficult. I guess the only thing I would say is that no credible professional body would support conversion therapy. So if any practitioner is deemed to be practicing conversion therapy, it should in the first instance be a matter for their professional regulator before it would be a legislative issue. But I don't know how we get that balance right of protecting people from conversion therapy and not frightening therapists who are just doing their job and having an appropriate exploratory conversation with a young person.
Thank you. That's helpful. It is one of the issues, I think, that on GOMI we do need to get right for both the clinicians and the young people, of course. I wonder if you could just give us a little information. One of the things that has been of interest is about the people presenting at the clinics who are same-sex attracted, and how we make sure that we do have that space for those young people. You mentioned a case earlier on in the session where someone perhaps did reflect on what had happened. And if I take it in context of a conversion therapy bill, do you think that we need to take that apart and look at a bill that deals with conversion therapy in terms of sex attraction and trans identity. Is that something we should consider?
I think we do need to. There are a very high percentage of these young people are same-sex attracted, and so you can see how the two things could get conflated. And I guess, this may have been naive, but one of the things that I was surprised about in conducting this review is how much homophobia there still is, as well as transphobia. So we do have to, support people in being able to express their and understand their sexuality as well as their gender identity.
Thank you. I have just one last question that has been raised with us, and it was around the including someone with trans identity in one of the reports that you in the review team. Was that something you considered?
Sorry, say again.
Why there was no trans people included in the review team?
Yes. So the review team was very small. There were only four or five people. So whilst, we weren't specifically excluding trans people from the review team, but we didn't have anyone who applied. But in a way, I think it's hard for a person on a team to be a sort of tokenistic anyway representative of the whole community. What we did ensure is that we had a very wide engagement. So we spoke every 4 to 6 weeks to the main trans advocacy groups. We had listening sessions. We had with service users. We had 18 focus groups with young people. We had roundtables with the support and advocacy groups. We had qualitative research that took account of both young people and young adults' experiences. We also consulted internationally, made every effort to incorporate service users' voice as broadly as we could.
That's really helpful. Thank you very much.
Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener. Dr. Cass, I wonder if I could just go back a little. You spoke about fearfulness of professionals in discussing this area, and then I know in answer to my colleague Carol Mochan around the issues of conversion and professionals having space to explore options with children and young people. You said research, guidance, training and supervision were the answers. Is there anything further? I mean, I know you'll have had personal experience of the heat and noise that surrounds this topic. I just wondered if you had anything further to add on that.
Yes, I think one of the things that was challenging for the Tavistock and the JID service is that they were a single provider, and any time when you have a single provider and you don't have peer review, you don't have the ability to share practice with other centres, that makes it very difficult. And that's why the way we're setting things up in England is that there's a single national provider collaborative where those centres can come together as an overarching structure to support all of the regional centres. And the idea is that it doesn't matter whether you walk into a service in Birmingham or London or Newcastle, whatever, you will get the same standards of care, the same decision making. And that means you have, shared clinical guidance, you have, shared training, the research works across, and really importantly, that you share data. You have a, shared data set that works across all those centres. And that was why I said that if, there was interest from Scotland that your centre became a regional centre, or, although it might not be physically, I can't speak for NHS England or the formal governance or any of that, but being able to share practice, I'm sure, is something that, would probably be welcome on both sides.
OK, thank you. Sandesh Kohani.
Thank you, convener. Dr. Cass, I know that adult services was outside of your scope, but you did mention them, and in point 1931, you stated that there was an expectation that patients would be started on masculinizing, feminizing hormones by their second appointment, which was a concern given the complexity of presentations. Did your research show anything similar with children's services?
I know that in the past there have been children and young people who have started on treatment relatively quickly. There was variability between the different, the different teams within the GID service, but that was certainly not supposed to be the way in which things operated. And I think certainly latterly there was more careful control to make sure that didn't happen. Just in terms of that comment about the adult services, I had a number of people with concerns from adult services who spoke to me, and that was their feedback to me. And given that they were seeing the same sorts of young people moving through who had that same complexity of presentation, they had clinical concerns about having to make those decisions so quickly.
Morning, Dr. Cass. I just want to pick up on a couple of areas that have already been discussed. Firstly, about the cohort of patients. So obviously the data is showing a huge and a very fast increase in birth registered females, the majority of whom are same-sex attracted. And this is a very different cohort from that looked at by the earlier studies. And the new cohort as well has a much more complexity of presentation. So you've suggested that care should routinely include, for instance, things like screening for neurodevelopmental conditions. I'm wondering if you can tell us a little bit more about this, the change in the cohort, the extent to which treatments had been based on the previous cohort, and what risks there might be around that.
Yeah, well, you've summarised it exactly. If you take, as I said, the research is already weak on the previous cohort and even more limited on this current cohort. So you can't make any assumptions that the original puberty blocker studies do read across to this group. And I think it's important that we consider this newer presenting group in the broader context of what's happening to adolescents in Gen Z more widely. So we know that there are very high rates of depression and anxiety. There are stressors that previous generations didn't have growing up in terms of social media and expectations on young people that arise from that early exposure to pornography. And we don't understand what any of those do to how you might present your distress. And certainly for some young people, that distress feeling that you don't fit the what you perceive to be the expected gender norms may manifest through questioning your gender identity, and that's why we really have to take this as a new cohort, not rely on previous research, and try and work with young people to help them unpick all of those things that may have led to that gender distress. I think one of the things that's been somewhat lost in the debate is that there's a really close mind-body interaction in, you know, that interaction between mental health and how you physically manifest it. And unpacking that is really complex and difficult and has to be done very carefully.
Thank you. And just on detransitioners, if I may.
We need to close on, I'm afraid we need to finish by 10 o'clock this session. Can I thank you, Dr. Cass, for your attendance today and for the information that you've given committee. I'm sure it'll help us in our further inquiries as we have other interested parties coming along to speak with us in the coming weeks. So thank you for your time. And I now suspend this meeting. Will we start then? The third item on our agenda is an evidence session with Food Standards Scotland, and I welcome to the committee Heather Kelman, Chair, Jeff Ogle, CEO, and Dr. Gillian Purton, Chief Nutritionist, all from Food Standards Scotland, and I invite you to make a brief opening statement.
Good morning, convener and members of the committee. Some of you I know quite well, but I recognise that committee membership has been refreshed since our attendance in January last year, and therefore I would like to take a couple of minutes to introduce ourselves and the work of FSS. In addition to Jeff Ogle and myself, and recognising that the committee is very interested in diet and health, we are joined by our Chief Nutritionist and Head of our Public Health Nutrition Department, Gillian Purton, who some of you may already know. Food Standards Scotland was established in April 2015 under the Food Scotland 2015 Act as the new public sector food body for Scotland. We are a non-ministerial office of the Scottish Administration, independent from Scottish Government ministers and from industry, and accountable to the Scottish Parliament. Our three key objectives are to protect the public from risk to health, which may arise in connection with the consumption of food, to improve the extent to which members of the public have diets which are conducive to good health, and to protect the other interests of consumers in relation to food. FSS is Scotland's independent public sector food body, collaborating closely with the Scottish Government, Public Health Scotland, Food Standards Agency, DEFRA, the UK Health Security Agency and the food businesses in Scotland to represent Scotland's interests in food-related issues both at home, UK level and abroad. Our purpose is public health protection. We have an annual budget of £22.7 million, which apart from an injection of £7 million to deal with the consequences of leaving the EU, has remained unchanged from our original allocation in 2015 of £15.7 million. 76% of our budget relates directly to staff costs. We employ around 290 staff, a decrease of approximately 26 staff since our report last year. Approximately half of our staff work in operational settings such as abattoirs, giving direct oversight to food production, ensuring food and animal feed is safe, compliant with food legislation. And our other AIM staff work to develop and help others develop policies on food and animal feed, advise the Scottish Government, other authorities and the public on food, feed and public health nutrition, provide guidance to the Scottish public and users of animal feed to help them make informed decisions about food and feedstuffs, investigate and disrupt criminal activity in the food supply chain, and monitor the performance of food enforcement authorities. Our annual report and accounts were laid before Parliament last November and summarised our performance for 22-23, a period of challenge which continued to address the knock-on effects of the UK's exit from the EU and to reset our priorities as inflation, increasing demand and a fixed budget made it essential that we focused on the key areas of work for FSS. And I commend the involvement of our staff in developing clarity and a vision on the way forward for the organisation. This work will continue as we recognise the need for the public sector to be as efficient as possible and to seek further opportunities to modernise and make best use of emerging technologies. Last year, we also published our second joint report on food standards, Our Food 2022, in conjunction with AIM, the Food Standards Agency. And I'm very pleased to inform the committee that the third report shall be available next month. This is a data and evidence-based annual status report tracking the safety and standards of food in the UK, aiming to ensure consumers and parliamentarians remain cited on the main changes and threats to our food system. Since we last met, FSS Board approved a new public health nutrition strategy designed to deliver our statutory duty to improve the extent to which the public have diets conducive to good health in Scotland. We have also engaged with a wide range of stakeholders to develop the strategy and also to encourage collaboration and a drive towards improved nutritional health in Scotland. As part of our work to protect consumers from food safety risks, we also created a new online allergen training tool to support food businesses and to give their staff a better understanding of food hypersensitivities. We delivered a number of risk assessments on various food products, for example, listeria in smoked fish or blue cheese, and updated our advice to the public on safe consumption of these foods. In response to a request from the Minister for advice on the diet-associated recommendations from the Climate Change Committee, FSS commissioned research from the University of Edinburgh, which has been widely acclaimed, and I believe we may discuss this a little further during today's session. Other consumer-facing campaigns included the promotion of the risks of Campylobacter to vulnerable groups, the campaign to promote the consumption of vitamin D supplements, and a farm prevention campaign to protect livestock from the deadly consequences of lead poisoning. The year ahead presents both challenges and opportunities for FSS. The continuing shortage of vets across the nation continues to challenge us. We are working very closely with all relevant bodies to find longer-term solutions, but the short-term measures to fill the gap is not only financially costly, but more importantly causing stress for our existing staff. The capacity and resilience of the food law enforcement regime remains compromised. Local authorities continue to have difficulty filling vacancies. An increasing workload, when councils have significant budget challenges, has placed local authority environmental health teams in a precarious position. The need to modernise our food law enforcement system continues to be a priority, and we have been working hard to find a source of funding to finance a transformation in food law enforcement. And in the meantime, we remain in close contact with our local authority partners to minimise the risks. I think I've said enough by way of an introduction and do not wish to take up any more of the committee's time and look forward to our discussion this morning. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Ms Kilman. And we'll move straight to questions. And Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to you, panel. The remit Food Standards Scotland is pretty huge, actually, and just hearing about what you have just described as it's broad ranging, and I'm really interested in the work that Food Standards Scotland does for a range of issues. As you will know, I will come on to issues around ultra-high processed foods in a wee minute, but I want to first talk about the University of Edinburgh research and recommendations about red meat consumption. We keep hearing about beef being really bad for the climate, and I worry that our farmers in Scotland are condemned for beef production when they do it really, really well. And Scotland's just a wee country that, in comparing to climate change with China, USA, Russia, other countries, Scotland is really down low on climate emissions. So I'm interested in hearing about the recommendations for reduction in red meat consumption. So 70 milligrams a day is now being recommended to 60 milligrams a day in order to have a 20% reduction in the average of intake projected. Right. So there's a lot of figures around it. So I'll be interested to hear what consideration that Food Standards Scotland has given to the findings of the University of Edinburgh research around reduction recommendations in red meat consumption.
Thanks for the question. Yeah, it's an interesting and complicated subject. I think just to be clear, in terms of where we focus, we focused on the risk assessment part of it. We were asked by ministers to look at the dietary implications of the Climate Change Committee recommendations. So the risk management decisions in terms of where that goes and what happens will rest with ministers who will want to consider a range of other factors that take the economics, societal attitudes, etc. into account. I think the issue for us was primarily looking at the health implications and the dietary implications of what the committee was recommending. So clearly, meat, dairy are important sources of protein. So the issue was actually around the effect on the diet if you actually reduce against current intakes. Now, the intakes are based on the Eat Well Guide. The 70 milligrams comes from the Eat Well Guide. I suppose our general observation was there's no doubt that the committee's objectives, would like to say, are stretching stroke challenging. But against where we currently sit against the Scottish dietary goals, we're some way off hitting those. So it seemed to us unlikely that if we're not actually hitting current targets, that we'd actually hit even more stretching targets going forward. The other thing around all of this, of course, you have to understand the kind of the social science around it and the behaviours. It's all right saying we need to reduce intake at a kind of population level, but within that you've got different behaviours from different sets of the population. In terms of the impacts, I suppose, it's not really for us, but certainly, you know, one of the things that comes to mind is, as I said, the behaviours thing. But, you know, if you have a kind of unilateral reduction in Scotland, but you don't do anything that changes behaviours and people are still consuming, then the chances are you're actually going to be importing more than you're actually producing and you're not actually solving the problem. That those are the sorts of things that ministers have to consider in terms of the wider views around what they do in terms of taking our risk assessment and then the conclusions they reach from it.
Julian, do you want to... Yeah, can I just come in on a few parts that you mentioned there in terms of the existing recommendations? So in Scotland, as Jeff mentioned, we have a set of Scottish dietary goals, and one of those goals is around red and red processed meat. And it's for high consumers to reduce from 90 grams to 70 grams. So that's what the modelling did. It really focused on those high consumers. And if we brought down the high consumers of red and red processed meat from the 90 to the 70, that would result in a 16% reduction in meat, which actually would go quite far to meeting those Climate Change Committee recommendations. So that's what the modelling did. And as Jeff says, because our diet overall is actually very poor, if we start removing really rich sources of not just protein but vitamins and minerals like red meat, then it has to be replaced with the right types of proteins. Otherwise, we'll become micronutrient insufficient. So there's quite a lot of risks to the population if we do that right across the board, and it has to really, we're really focused on looking at existing recommendations and bringing everybody into that. The 70-gram limit, the reason for those recommendations is around colorectal cancer risk. So when we did the NAP modelling, we were able to look at that. With dairy, it's a lot more difficult. So we didn't have any recommendations around reduction in dairy. Dairy is very important within the diet, so, and there's no health benefits of reducing dairy. In fact, it's quite protective, so we didn't have any recommendations there around reducing dairy. But with meat, we looked at those existing recommendations. And actually, it's one of the only dietary goals that we're actually meeting. Most of the others we don't meet, and we actually are at a population level underneath that 70 grams. But obviously, there are subparts that are above where we are. So,
And just to think about, you know, the alternatives to meat, for instance, you know, I was looking up the numbers of what 70 grams means, and you know, a plate of spaghetti bolognese has about 100 grams of meat, and a quarter pounder of beef burgers, 90 grams. So I was trying to like put in my head, what does all that mean? It's an, like a full Scottish breakfast can be about 90 grams as well. So you get your whole daily recommendation in one meal. But if you were vegetarian for the rest of the week, that might actually be acceptable. So it'd be interesting to look at, how do we then support replacing red meat with other things like eggs and legumes, other vegetable options? I mean, that is part of how do we, I suppose, support the nutrients that you talk about, Dr. Purdon. So what would Food Standards Scotland be able to do to help recommend people to have alternatives?
So I think we have a lot, as we mentioned earlier, the existing advice that we have is around the Eat Well Guide. And what we've done is we've got a model diet for over a week, and we looked at the amount of meat within that, and that's well below that 70 grams for exactly those reasons. You can have more meat on some days, but then other days with no meat, and it balances out across the piece. So in terms of the replacements, looking at things like beans and pulses, they're cheap. You're able to, you know, buy those readily available within in the shops, and actually we do see that over time
consumers have been purchasing less meat, and we think that's more to do with the fact that the cost of meat rather than it is to do with anything relating to health particularly. So I think it's looking at those alternatives and actually not necessarily going for, as you mentioned earlier, ultra-processed meat replacements, but actually looking at the beans, pulses, fish, eggs as alternatives that we've obviously got very, very much of those are widely available within Scotland. Mm-hmm.
Can I just add a little bit to that, Emma, just to say that on our website we have a tool called Eat Well Your Way, which gives advice to individual consumers on how to nudge their diet more closely towards the Eat Well Guide, so people can have a look at that and actually have get some practical advice on how to change their diet towards the Eat Well Guide.
Okay. Just a final question about ultra...
Just before you do, you don't need to work the microphones, broadcasting does, so... You don't need to touch them to put them on.
OK, I am conscious there's loads to cover, but I want to focus on ultra-high-processed foods. We know that Henry Dimbleby and Jemima Lewis were co-authors of a book called Ravenous, and Henry Dimbleby presented at Dynamic Earth recently about shaping the science for Scotland's food future event, and it was really interesting to hear Henry Dimbleby talk about his research and talk about the work and the food strategy that he was proposing. And we know that the food system is really, really complicated, but that in terms of replacing good welfare produced Scottish lamb, Scottish beef with a meat replacement that contains, you know, chemicals that are stabilisers, emulsifiers, xanthan gum, guar gum, colours, flavourings, all of this stuff that's got chemicals in it, you know, it's been labelled as industrially created enteric substances. So is it really food if we are looking at a replacement for the best welfare produced meat that we have in Scotland already, and replacing that with stuff that's got unpronounceable chemicals in it? So I'd be interested in what your thoughts are about ultra high processed food and how that links with high fat, sugar and salt, for instance.
Yeah.
No, I was wondering, did Gillian want to take it
to
start with
her? Right.
Go on, Jeff,
go first. Oh, right, OK. So, yeah, I mean, there's a lot of debate and discussion about ultra-processed foods at the moment, and the board discussed this particular issue in March. I think it's a nuanced and complicated subject. Certainly, I think it's important to separate out a kind of qualitative issue from a safety issue. So anything that is used in food, whether it's an additive, a multiplier, whatever, has got to go through a pretty rigorous risk assessment, has got to be approved and has got to be shown that it's safe before it can be used, which is a separate thing, I think, to your point about the quality of food that's being consumed. I think the other thing, again, what the board paper said is if you actually look at ultra-processed foods, what you'll find is a lot of high-fat, salt and sugar foods are ultra-processed foods. So if you're concerned about ultra-processed foods, eat less high-fat, salt and sugar foods, and by definition you'll be eating a lot less ultra-processed foods. But the other thing about it is it's a bit more nuanced because of the way in which the definitions work. So, for example, if you had steak every single day, is that an ultra-processed food? No. But actually, it does present some health risk, colorectal cancer and everything else that Gillian's just mentioned. So it's not, and again, you know, certain types of food, vegan foods, for example, require a degree of processing. I think for us, and Heather can speak on behalf of the board, but I think the point for us really is it's the focus on the high fat, salt and sugar, because that's where, in dietary terms, most of the ultra-processed food is not actually supporting a healthy diet. It's, in fact, doing the reverse. So that is where we think there is the issue with UPFs. And if you focus on high fat, salt and sugar, you will reduce your UPF intake.
So just to come back, in terms of that ultra-processed food, and that classification comes from the NOVA classification. So there's four different groups within that. So the first one being unprocessed, and you're red meat, for example, would be one of those. Then you've got processed culinary ingredients, things like oils, things like that. Then you have processed foods, and they're in the category of things like tins of you know, plain tins of beans or something like that, not baked beans, because baked beans would fall into ultra-processed, because you look at the label and see lots of different ingredients. That tends to be one of the things. However, when this was this system was developed, it wasn't based on nutrients. It's primarily based on processing. So what we don't know from the evidence base is there's evidence emerging that these ultra-processed foods might be detrimental to health, but we're not able to ascertain what that could be. Is it an element to do with the processing? Is it an ingredient? That's not clear at the moment. So we'll look at the evidence base. We asked the Scientific Advisory Committee on Nutrition to review the evidence base, which they did. And we've gone to the committee. They're going to keep it on their horizon scan, but at the moment there's not enough evidence there to really support a change in policy around ultra-processed foods. But that's not to say that could come in the future, and we'll certainly make sure we keep our eye on that emerging evidence base. But as Jeff says, where we do have sufficient evidence is around high-fat, salt, sugar food. We know that they're bad for them. We know the different mechanisms and how that works. And if we could reduce that within the population in Scotland, that would be a really big effort towards. We know that about 15% of our energy, our calories, comes from those types of food, high-fat, salt, sugar food. So they're so pervasive right through everybody's diet that we know that a lot of them have very little benefit, but they do a lot more harm. So rather than, I think, be distracted, if that's the right term, in this UPF kind of debate, I think it's important that we keep focused on where the evidence base is.
OK, thanks. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Gillian Kay.
Thanks, Convener. Emma's covered, I think, most of what I was going to ask, but given the number of issues we've just covered around nutrients and reducing things by 20 grams versus, obviously there's a lot of evidence coming out about how diet could change with climate recommendations and things as well. How does Food Standards Scotland approach communicating some of this? There's obviously the Eat Well guide, but there's no guarantee that some of this evidence that comes out over the next however long could impact some of what the Eat Well recommendations are now. And some of this is quite nuanced and for potentially higher consumers to reduce rather than everybody overall. And there's then potentially those knock-on impacts for groups that could be more affected by some of these changes than others if they're in potentially some of the lower ranges of those consuming meat at the moment. So how do we, there's a lot in that question as well, how do we approach that information environment as a whole, but how do we make sure that we're taking in some of those underrepresented, potentially vulnerable groups as well in doing all of that?
Well, I'll start, because I think one of the things we've become very aware of at Food Standards Scotland is we've got to understand the targeting of messages, mm-hmm. and our corporate communications department has been looking very closely at how we use social media to get to particular target groups for certain messages. For example, like the food safety issues that we just talked about, there were certain groups that really should avoid eating, you know, smoked fish, for example. So we've become much better at understanding those groups that we need to target, mm-hmm. and addressing the messages directly to them as much as we can. We addressed at the board the fact that this would be a very complicated message to get out, because obviously there's some people, young females, who, for them to reduce their meat intake further, if they're already at the sort of 50, 60 grams, could actually be quite detrimental to their health. So we have to be very careful about how we nuance that message. So we don't have all of that detail yet, but it is actually very clearly stated that that's what we've got to do, is to think very carefully about the messaging, the targeting, and making sure that we are focused on the right groups. Our team analyse lots of data on food eating patterns. And, you know, the research that was done by University of Edinburgh pulled a lot on our Intake 24 survey data, which let us know exactly where those groups were. So we're trying to use evidence to focus and target for the future messaging. But, yes, it's going to be a challenge. We're just waiting to see what the final recommendations are.
The other thing we've been doing, we've been looking at the design of our website as well, and we've been doing quite a lot of research around how it's currently structured and what changes we can make to it, and it's partly to get a better differentiation between, if you like, the consumer needs and the business needs, because we're supporting both. So that's one of the challenges. I think the other thing that kind of we need to kind of work on and works in our favour is we do a biannual consumer tracker, And levels in trust of FSS are pretty high. It's about 78%, which in government terms is pretty good. I just thought I'd get that in. So I think the part of the issue is actually being that trusted source, and particularly with health and diet, because there is so much coverage mm-hmm. of it, and it is easy to take up mixed messages or get the wrong message. The thing for us is about being that trusted source, and then it's about how do you make sure, if you are the trusted source, how do you make it easy to find the information? That's some of the stuff we're doing on our website. And I think the other thing is, again, which is part of our comms strategy, is how we can work with other organisations and use other organisations to get our messages across. Mm-hmm. So I think we just, it's one of those things, there's no right answer, you just have to kind of keep developing it as kind of attitudes, and comms means change and develop.
And I suppose finally just to say that we, particularly around diet, there's a big say-do gap. So whilst mm-hmm. a lot of people know the message, for example, around five a day, you know, that's how many portions of fruit and veg we should eat, people don't do that. And the question is why? Now, that can be resources, but it's also looking at our food environment, where we live, and trying mm-hmm. making things easier for people to get a healthier diet and eat a healthier diet. And that's where there's a lot of big challenges. So it's not just communicating directly to the consumers, but it's doing things in the background that actually facilitate mm-hmm. these changes as well. And as Heather says, our Intake 24 dietary assessment tool is integrated into the health survey every 3 years. So that's mm-hmm. really fantastic. Now it gives us an ability to track over time, which we've not had before, and look at different population subgroups. And we've also got a survey of children ongoing at the moment, which I can talk to in a bit more detail if that's helpful. But we will then be able to look at what children are eating, which is a big gap for us for quite a long time.
That's great. Thanks, convener.
Sanjay Gohani.
Thank you. Just a declaration of interest as a practicing NHS GP. I have to say I'm a bit disappointed to hear that this reduction in red meat is due to the climate report and not simply as a discussion about healthy eating. And I was really glad that Dr. Purdin did eventually get in about the risk of colorectal cancer, because ultimately we need to eat a wide variable diet with a rainbow plate, one red meat a week, and far more fish and far more vegetables into our diet. And I'm glad Dr. Purdin mentioned the food environment, because that is what I want to speak about. And my first question is, I heard that Greggs are approximately 200 metres from a school. All Greggs. Is that accurate?
Well, I don't think we've actually looked specifically at Greggs. I think we've raised concerns about the proximity of high-fat salt sugar outlets close to schools and the need to look at planning legislation and how we actually make sure that there's some control over that. But we haven't specifically looked at Greggs per se. I mean, I suppose because you've brought up Greggs on its own, I think what is challenging for me is I have seen evidence of where Greggs is actually based in a hospital, and they're quite capable of producing a very healthy range of foods available when it's within the contract. It's a hospital in the north of England that Greggs won the contract for being one of the shops in the mall. So it is possible for these outlets to actually offer a broader range, the rainbow of foods, as you so rightly describe, and to encourage people to not just go for the pastries, the high-fat, salt, sugar foods. And I'd like to see the food environment change, where food businesses take more responsibility for offering to our public that healthy range of foods that we require to have. I think there's a real cultural issue in the UK and in Scotland about how we view food. We've become more focused on refuelling rather than actually on the social and mental health and benefits of eating a proper varied diet. So it's not just physical health that can gain from this, our emotional and mental health can gain as well. And I think that around schools is a particularly vulnerable area where we should make sure that there is the full range of food outlets available.
So I do want to come back onto schools, but I do feel, though, if we look at supermarkets, and I don't particularly want to start banning things, but let's look at a meal deal. You get a sandwich, a drink, and something else for a set price. I don't know many people who would choose a single banana over that massive chocolate bar. because, you know, if you just look at value, a single banana is, you know, in Aldi it's 16 pence. But that chocolate bar is a pound something, so you think, well, I'll go for the thing with value. So should we not be encouraging that single piece of fruit, which has a very low value to the supermarket, to be given for free with that meal deal, regardless of what you're choosing? So maybe the person would choose to eat the fruit instead of the chocolate and save that for later, maybe not even eat it.
Yeah, I'm happy to come in on that. So just at the moment, Scottish Government have a consultation out looking at restricting promotions of high fat salt sugar foods. It closes, I think, later on in May. So still time to respond to that consultation, and I would encourage everybody to do so. But as part of that, they're looking at meal deals. Now, this is not incorporated within the English legislation, so they're looking at meal deals as well, and that's part exactly, as you point out, whether meal deals with unhealthy high-fat salt sugar foods should be allowed to be, you know, sold as a meal deal. And so I think that's part of what they're wanting to look at. And also things like unlimited free refills, other things that are encouraging us to have more high-fat salt sugar food than we might have otherwise. Because you're absolutely right, when it's a meal deal, it's tempting, you know, you're on a budget, you want to get the best value potentially. So that's something that they want to do. And I think from our evidence, we know that these, as I said earlier, actually these types of foods, are the kind of discretionary foods, as we would call them, really contribute significantly to our diets, and we really need to rebalance. We need to make those healthier foods more appealing, more economically viable, and therefore, you know, more so that people on lower incomes as well are more able to purchase the healthier types of food and not tempted towards those unhealthy foods.
Sorry. On the point just of that, the supermarket knows everything about me, mm-hmm. Through all my cards that I've got. I don't know if they even track the way I walk through the supermarket. But what we do know is that the most valuable spaces are the shelves at eye level, yep. And the end of aisle shelves, and what you walk into. So again, if you look at a Lidl or an Aldi, it's fruit you walk into, which isn't always the case. A lot of times it's in other supermarkets, it's that high sugar content. Should we be looking at legislation or ways of making sure that healthy foods are at the premium place rather than unhealthy foods, which I think is the case right now?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a good point. So the legislation is looking at restricting unhealthy foods in those position points or checkouts, the end of aisles and those key points, whether or not we should be going further and actually saying that's where you need to position the stuff that we need to rebalance. I'd be very much for that, and I think that's something I don't think the legislation, the consultation at the moment is going that far, but perhaps that's what we've spoken to Ms. Minto about this, and, you know, having it as a piece of legislation that then can be built on to encourage things to go further. I think this is the first step in terms of restricting where the unhealthy things are.
I'll just add as well, I think there's a broader question around the food environment. I think you're absolutely right in terms of placing of product. It is influential, there's no doubt about it. But I think, you know, we've now got some pretty good evidence, for example, around the introduction of the sugar levy, which the UK government didn't introduce as a revenue generator. They introduced it to actually encourage and speed up reformulation. So you have got evidence that says if you introduce policies around reformulation and you back it up with a kind of fiscal measure, it does work. So you now can get, you know, I think Coca-Cola now sells more of its diet and zero than it does its full sugar version. But, you know, you can now get, you know, cans of soft drink with no calories in or very little sugar. But then you go and buy a sort of pasta and you've got 5, 6, 7 teaspoons in it. So why is it we've got a situation that says there's a sugar levy on a soft drink but not a sugar levy on other food products? So I think there's a broader reformulation question. You know, in a way, the placement of the product is kind of taking advantage of the fact that these products can be produced in the first place. If you reformulate, take the sugar out, reduce the calorie content, the high fat, salt and sugar, as well as tackling the kind of product placement, then I think you're getting a much healthier food environment in the first place.
Thank you. And certainly, you know, a lot of people that speak to me say Iron Brew's been ruined by this. Can I just very finally, and it's a big topic, and it's not fair to give you just one question on it, but school meals. We need to see big healthy choices when it comes to school meals and being that being encouraged over other types of food. Do you feel that the best place to start with that will be in our nursery and very young children, with teachers having possibly the time to be able to introduce different flavours and tastes to children who might never have experienced that type of food, to make those choices going through the school environment so they actively make the choice as the child?
So recently, the Scientific Advisory Committee on Nutrition have put out new recommendations for 1 to 5, and we're currently working with Public Health Scotland and Scottish Government. So it's a Scottish Government-led piece of work for guidance for 1 to 5-year-olds. So that will cover nurse supervision, and it's to incorporate the new scientific evidence and make sure that that plays through. So yeah, that will hopefully be published, I think, later this year, and then that will be incorporated within the guidance for nurseries. So those types of things are all being considered as part of that review. In terms of school food does have requirements for fruit and veg, and I think in the primary school setting works really well. I think, as you alluded to earlier, when you get to secondary school, that's where there's more challenges with proliferation perhaps of outlets around the school. So I think there, that's where the National Planning Framework 4 comes in, and there are, that can help stop opening of new outlets, but existing outlets will remain. And I think in terms of looking at those existing outlets, we're working with Scottish Government and again Public Health Scotland on an out-of-home action plan, and part of that is an eating out, eating well framework. We've got about 50 businesses currently in a pilot scheme at the moment, looking at implementing a number of different aspects so the food is healthier and more sustainable that they're providing. So we're looking at improving provision within existing outlets, and then I think there's the frameworks there to look at the proliferation of new and opening up to make sure that they're not all unhealthy. Because not all outlets necessarily need to be unhealthy, but when children at the age when they can leave the school, I think that's where we need to create that healthier food environment again, but out of home, not just in the retail environment.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Emma Harper has a brief supplementary on this.
Thanks. It's just a wee sup. As part of the Scottish Government's consultation, I think one of the questions was about restricting the sale of high-fat sugar salt within 2 metres of the checkout. I think that was part of what's been asked in the consultation. I mean, what Sandesh has brought up is actually valid about, you know, product placement in supermarkets. So there are challenges for us in Scotland when it comes to marketing and advertising, because we can't control what Ofcom have reserved matters as far as advertising on television. But in terms of in supermarkets, that would be something that we can certainly advocate for, would be product placement where at the end of the aisle or 2 metres from a checkout. Is that something that we could be supporting?
As far as I'm aware, yeah, that's absolutely what we can support.
I think the other thing is, I'd say one of the things we also need to look at, though, is you need to look at the overall retail sector, not just the big supermarkets. If you look at the proportion that's bought in local shops, for example, smaller shops, there's a general issue around the food environment, I think, that we need to look at. And for smaller businesses, that's more of a challenge. My view is that doesn't mean they should not be included or looked at. It just means you might have to have a slightly different answer to, you know, for example, give them more time to comply or whatever it may be. But I think we need to, when we're talking about the food environment, it's not just the big retail, it's the whole thing. And we need to make sure we're covering the whole thing.
Okay, thanks. Thank you. We do have a lot to get through in the next 45 minutes, so if I could ask members to keep their questions short and to the point, and the panel, if you can please be a bit more concise with your answers. Thank you. Paul Sweeney.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener. Obviously, the supermarket distribution and wholesale system is a huge influence over behaviours on food consumption, and a large part of it isn't necessarily to do with poverty, but also tight in financial sense, but also time poverty, that people are thinking at the margins. Increasingly single occupancy households are just picking things that are convenient to make usually late in the evenings, whatever. So just to see if there's any guidance around product bundling that you may be able to provide to retailers that could help them to package or offer more healthy options for people to choose. I mean, there's been significant progress in improving the Scottish density of supply chain products in supermarkets. I think Aldi is currently the leader with 25% Scottish sourced products. But it'd be interesting to know more about that. Certainly, when you look at products like HelloFresh, they are providing someone with a kind of immediately ready kit to make a nutritional meal, but it's quite expensive. It's quite a high end offer. How can we make that more of a normal choice and actually use it as a way to seed the supply chain density in Scotland?
Within the Scottish Grocers Healthy Living Programme, that has been looked at, so where you have recipe cards, that's in sort of local shops, so smaller shops, often in areas of more deprived areas. And so they've looked at providing those kind of recipe cards and then potentially a saving on those bundles of ingredients. I don't know how easy it is to do it with the bigger retailers, but it's something that we could potentially look at in the future.
Yeah, I mean, I think there has been a bit of a market shift. I mean, again, kind of demographics come into all of this as well. But certainly we are seeing, I think, Greg's was mentioned earlier on, but I think, things like lunchtime offers, the meal deal with less than 600 calories. So I think there's something about how retail kind of taps into that kind of social demand. I suppose there's the question around, do they create the social demand or do consumers create it? So that gets a bit murky and a bit complicated. But I think what it does demonstrate is that it can be done. The question is it being done enough? And is it being done in an affordable way? And I think that's where the challenge is. There's definitely perceptions that eating healthier costs more, and to some degree it does. So there is something about how you can tap into that kind of calorie consciousness at the same time in a way that is affordable for the full range of the population, not just those that have got sufficient income.
We've seen the development of food pantries, particularly in urban areas, which have been really positive in recent years. She declared interest as a trustee of the Courtyard Pantry in Glasgow. But I would be interested to know more about what efforts have been made to cooperate with local authorities on turning more parkland, for example, over to cultivation. One of the big challenges we've seen with local government budget cuts in recent years has been a collapse in financing for urban parks. So, for example, in Glasgow, I think the budget is down 80% over the last decade on parks. Could there be an opportunity to promote greater agricultural use of urban parkland that would allow the councils to actually reduce the budget pressures on maintaining what were traditionally manicured landscapes?
It's a little bit outside our remit, but that doesn't mean that we're not highly motivated to contribute to Good Food Nation planning. And I think that sits very much within the Good Food Nation plan's opportunities going forward, is to ask councils to look at what opportunities they have to re-engage the public with growing food, producing food for themselves. And I think that's as part of that vision that we want to create for Scotland of what does a Good Food Nation look like, and do we have more opportunities for community gardens or community production.
Okay. Just also wanted to touch on public procurement. You remember kind of mentioned it in school meals and so on, but how engaged are you in decision making around public procurement on food and the quality of that and the supply chain design? Is that something you take an active role in, or is it more just guidance that you provide? I'm just kind of curious as to how you operate in that space.
Public procurement, generally it's not our lead. We will provide support and evidence in terms of where it's going. So Julian talked earlier on about school meals. So there was a review of school meals and we contributed to that. And obviously that's a fairly big area of public procurement. But in terms of things like hospital procurement, for example, it's not really an area that we would lead. And one would hope that the NHS has got kind of the nutritionist it needs to provide the advice it's necessary for a healthy diet. So, we are here to give advice to ministers. Ministers can request advice from us, and we have done it in the past, but it's not a kind of regular and ongoing activity for us.
Forgive me if it's already something that's out there, but it seems like in the case of supermarkets, we can sort of see the range of products, we can see where the supply chain densities are in terms of geography. Is that kind of visibility there with the public sector, you know, in terms of what the NHS density is in terms of procurement from certain farms or certain locations in Scotland? There's obviously large sort of industrial catering companies like Bidfood and Breaks, etc., that would supply these organisations, but is there that kind of visibility? And do you think that's something, if it isn't there, that we should maybe design to give greater, you know, capacity for us to make rational adjustments?
Again, that's not something that, that falls directly within our remit, but I do think that as health boards and local authorities have to go through their writing and their development of their own Good Food Nation plans, that's one of the areas that I think they will be looking at closely, is how they procure and how they can, you know, what best practice is there. I'm not sure if that's an area that the incoming Scottish Food Commission might look at.
Carol Morgan.
Thank you, Convener. I'm interested, you've covered a lot of what I was going to ask, so I'm interested, I suppose, in the notion that if we want to meet our targets, particularly around childhood obesity, we need to move from talking about things to actually actioning things. So I hugely believe that governments have to take responsibility for their part in the picture. It's not all about that individual choice, because we know that the communities are not set up in that way, particularly areas where we have high levels of health inequality. So if you were going to give us three pieces of homework, I suppose, to push in terms of actual action, what do you think is achievable for us to push the government on?
I think I would love to see some of the you know, the promotion, the work on the promotions bill that's going through, I would really like to see that come forward, preferably with cross-party support, because one of the things that the industry and the food industry needs is confidence so that they can reformulate for the future. And if they think that this is a sort of something that will change in the future, they're not going to get that long-term horizon that will force them or encourage them to look more closely at reformulation and changing the range of products that's out there. So I think that's one of my first ones, is to really look at how we tackle that high-fat, salt-sugar promotions. We're also very keen, we've just written to a number of health spokespeople down in Westminster on the advertising and marketing. And I think that actually requires a four-nation approach to really push to get some of this marketing issues addressed. I think it's unacceptable that we allow high-fat, salt-sugar to be promoted during childhood watching times, and I think that will require a four-nation approach to get movement on that. I might let Gillian have the third one. I mean, I've got a long list, but I'll let Gillian have the third one as the head of nutrition.
Well, I think it's a good question, but maybe quite difficult to answer. So I think I would agree with you in the terms of promotions and these bigger pictures. I think the reason it's difficult to answer is because what we're talking about is preventative measures, and quite a lot of the time we want to prevent things happening, and that therefore they're quite upstream. So you're talking about reformulation, you're talking about making sure that things are promoted that are healthy and not unhealthy, those types of things. But I think things, some of the activities like universal free school meals would be really beneficial, and that is something that's within the gift of Scottish Government there. A lot of work that they are doing that's existing and progressing around the promotions legislation particularly, I think that's also really important. But yeah, I think it's quite difficult to, maybe the early years as well as another area for putting resource into, which I know Scottish Government are doing. But again, we're all in the same position in terms of having limited resources. So there's got to be partnership working, I think, there too. And Scottish Government and Public Health Scotland can do a lot more at that community level, which maybe touches on some of Paul's kind of questions around looking at what's actually happening in communities as well. So I think the good news is that we are all working together on these aspects, so that we can have that sort of synergy and kind of we're greater than the sum of our individual parts, if you like, in that approach.
I'm interested as well, and there's some talk around, you know, label foods, don't label foods, particularly menus, eating out, those kind of issues. Where are you on those issues at the moment?
So it's terms of mandatory calorie labelling, which is something that we'd previously recommended through to ministers, the government at the moment were very aware of an emerging evidence base around the impact of menu calorie labelling on those with eating disorders, and commissioned a piece of research from Public Health Scotland, which was quite recently published. We also know that at the moment within England there's an evaluation of the scheme in England, because you may or may not be aware, but big businesses within England, so above 250 employees, have to have menu calorie labelling. So there's been a big evaluation of that, and that's something that we're also taking into account. So at the moment, we're going to be speaking to our board at a closed seminar to update them on where the evidence base is, and then later be returning to the minister with an updated position on that, because we have to be, you know, we're basically a science and evidence-based organisation, so we need to make sure that we're alive to the existing and emerging evidence. What we do know, though, is we are tasked with monitoring the out-of-home food environment in terms of the provisions there, and it's extremely difficult due to the lack of information about calorie information. So, in a way, regardless of whether consumers see it, I think it's important that businesses are aware, because at the moment, a lot of businesses aren't aware of what they're actually providing and to the consumer. So there's various different elements, but we're looking at all of that because we're mitigating any potential harm.
Can I just very quickly? I think the one thing I would add to the list of asks is the case of transparency. So Dimbleby talked about the food data transparency partnership, which was requiring industry to be more open in terms of things like sugar content and everything else. And, you know, that seems to have kind of gone very, very quiet. But I think, you know, the fact that you make something more visible so consumers have more information, I think the issue is about how you make information available to consumers. Because I think once consumers do get that information, at least they've got the opportunity to change. Whereas if they've got no information at all, it's difficult to know.
Yeah, that's really helpful. Thank you.
Thanks. And just on a wee bit of a follow-up on something that you were mentioning earlier on about reformulation of particularly drinks in anticipation and then the introduction of the sugar tax. So we know that sweeteners can have adverse effects and that they don't make the drinks any less sweet. I take on board Mr. Kohani saying that it might change the taste, but it doesn't make them any less sweet, so it doesn't retrain the taste buds. So to what extent do you believe that replacing sugar with artificial sweeteners is a correct approach?
So I think one thing just to say in terms of the evidence base around that, there is evidence that that a reduction in sugar or sugar sweetened beverages can support people with type 2 diabetes to help lose weight and things like that. So there is some evidence around that, and we know that the introduction of the soft drinks industry levy has resulted in really some beneficial effects in terms of teenage girls, reduction of obesity rates there. So we know there are some positive impacts with that. But having said that, I take your point on board entirely, and that doesn't help with that sweet tooth and the fact that these, you know, the pervasive nature of the high fat salt sugar foods and drinks within our food environment and trying to get away from that taste. So I think that is something we need to look at. I don't know how easy it is to do in terms of reformulation, not being an expert, but certainly with salt, the industry were quite well placed to gradually reduce those salt levels, and that was the way that the palate of the consumer became familiar with it and didn't reject it, if you like. So I don't know that the same thing has happened with sweeteners because they're so intensely sweet. So I think there is a question mark around that, and I don't think we really have the answer as to how easy it would be to sort of try and dial that down a little bit.
Yeah. And Paul Sweeney, I believe you've got supplementary. Yeah.
It was just on the point around the calorie publications. Have you noticed a change in the behaviour of food providers to reduce the calorie density in response to something being excessively calorie dense? Like if it's, you know, 1,500 calories for a meal, they might be like, oh, that's actually quite alarming to the consumer. Well, let's try and reduce it to 800 or something.
Yes and no, I think, is the answer to that. So, yes, there is some evidence that when I mean, that's one of the key things that, a business, that happens to a business, once they actually work out the calories, then they make menu changes and basically reformulate what's on their menu so it's not as high in calories. So we do have some evidence for that, but probably isn't that evidence base isn't as robust as we'd like it to be, but that is one of the biggest impacts that we've seen. And we've got a tool on our website called MenuCal, which is it can assist a smaller business, any business you would like, but to put calories on menus. And we did a pilot survey quite a long time ago now, but one of the things we did find that when businesses were using that tool, it made them realise how many calories were in the stuff that we're providing, and they made quite significant changes because they thought, wow, 2,000 calories in mac and cheese, I didn't realise that, and they reformulated as a result. So I think it can, that knowledge can also, whether the consumer knows it or not, impact on the business practices, which is kind of a really big, important part that often is kind of missed.
Okay, thank you.
David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to your witnesses. Food Standard Scotland's website is a source of evidence-based nutrition-related information, but has to compete with the misinformation that consumers may access through other digital sources. How can Food Standard Scotland ensure that its evidence-based message and advice are heard?
It's a good question, and it goes back to the point I made earlier on, I think, about the amount of information that is out there. And certainly misinformation sits as a kind of risk for us in terms of something that we continually monitor. I think some of it is going back to that point I made about being a trusted source. The other thing we do is, I think it's called social media listening. I don't profess to be an expert on this, but basically actually looking at what people are talking about and actually, kind of interrogating what is happening in terms of social media. And then thinking about using that. I mean, the reality is we do not have the resource to address every kind of story and every piece of misinformation. So I think for us, the issue is really about where we concentrate our effort. And a good example of that is the kind of UPFs, where we noticed there's a surge in media, there's a lot of interest. We've had a board discussion on it. And rather than get involved in the debate and commentary, we put the board paper onto the website and then let people look at it. So I think some of it is actually about making sure our evidence is there and standing up so that people have got the source of truth. So I think that really is the main thing, really. It's about listening to what's going on and then actually being, I suppose, quite specific and focused in terms of where you do interject into a debate or not. So another one, for example, last year before, there's quite a lot of debate about use by dates and best before dates and should you get rid of use by dates, etc. So again, we just let's cut through the debate, we'll take a paper to the board, we'll get the factual position and then we'll make that available. So I think it for us, the kind of consumer trust is really the kind of bedrock of making sure that kind of misinformation thing is handled by us in the right way.
Thank you for that. Has Food Standards Scotland undertaken any work to influence school curriculum, particularly relating to education of children around online nutrition-related misinformation on popular apps such as Instagram and TikTok?
It's interesting. It's a good question. It's something that we did debate with the board in a closed seminar in terms of looking at. The curriculum does have a lot on diet, it has a lot on the Scottish Dietary Goals, but I think whether that needs a refresh to actually reflect the current situation, as you say, with the social media, with the fact that the food environment it's not just that physical environment, it's that virtual environment as well, so it's all the advertising promotion, it's all the and that's pervasive right through all of that social media platforms, so it's not something that we've kind of made any inroads at the moment to progressing with, but I think it is certainly on our radar to do kind of list in terms of looking at how that can be updated a bit, because as I say, there's quite a lot in there, but it maybe just doesn't go quite far enough as yet.
There I'm going to ask again is, does Food Standards Scotland have a strong social media presence? Because if you're trying to influence a certain age group, especially a younger generation, yep. It has to be strong, and how would you measure it? Because your website, you could measure how many hits are on it, or anybody looks at your social media stuff. So do you do that?
Yeah, we have quite a few stats. It might be easy if we could say we send you some information on it, because we do actually collect quite a lot of information in terms of the whole social media, press coverage, the whole range of communications. So we can make some of that available to you to see. So in terms of hits, I mean, I think it's like a lot of organisations, you're competing in a very, very cluttered landscape. And going back to some of the analysis I talked about earlier, when we've been doing some research with the people using it, it's the thing is actually around what they're going on for and what they're trying to find, and how you make it more visible and easy to access. I think, if I'm honest, one of the issues for us at the moment is we need to make information more accessible on things like diet, for example. So I think there is our kind of search engine is really kind of out of date and clunky, and that needs to change. So we know what we need to do. We're just in the process of doing it now.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Sweet.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for coming today. I've got two questions. So just building on what David Torrance said, has Food Standards Scotland undertaken any work to influence the school curriculum? Because as we know, the children are more likely to go on social media, as David said, in relation to particularly TikTok and Instagram. So it's that impacting the school curriculum.
I think it's not something that we, in the past we have, and as I say, the Scottish Dietary Goals, there are elements of our recommendations, the Eat Well Guide, that's all part of the curriculum. I think once the social media element and some of these aspects, I think it is a good point you raise and something that we can take away, but it's not something that we have actively been involved with in terms of the school curriculum. There are others that do a lot of work in this area, like Bite Back, and they have really good campaigns which help to empower the young people in terms of knowing what's actually happening and the manipulations around them. So I think it's something that we can certainly take away and see if that's something. I don't know the curriculum in enough detail really to know how much that's covered, but it's certainly something that we could.
Good, thank you. And looking at your search engines and updating those so that people come to you as a go-to.
Yeah, that's
site.
All going to be part, I think, of the website overhaul, because even with the nutrition pages, there's the stuff that we want for the consumers, so that's the advice and information, but also we want access to the research. So we have a nutrition hub, so where all our research is. So they're totally different audiences, and it's making sure that that's nice and easy to navigate and clear. So the likes of anyone interested in the detail of why we've recommended something can find that, as much as finding the information around diet as well.
Thank you. And my second question, so there's a craze going on right now, which is carnivore diet, paleo, keto, and there's one particular group that sticks in my mind that sprung up, very successful group during COVID and post-COVID, that took hold of social media. And there's evidence coming from the States, from doctors in the States, and a study that they're quoting Harvard University, and they're doing their own social media questionnaires, actually saying keto, paleo, where people are taking control of their own and getting the nutrients from, let's say, red meat and eggs diet, which does fly in the face of what you're purporting in your report, which is eat less red meat. So do you have a view? Is that something that you don't know about yet and you will be taking to your board, which is listening to what's going on? As I say, it's taking a huge hold right now. Thank you.
So just in terms of the tracker survey that Jeff talked about earlier, that is something we can ask questions around that, and we do normally ask questions around if somebody's on a particular diet.
Are you aware of that? That's going on.
Yeah, I mean, those
right
types
now.
Of diets have been around a long, long time. So yes, we are aware, and that's why we would ask those questions to identify if people are on specific diets or they're following a specific diet for whatever reason. And it's broader than it can be for religious reasons, for ethical reasons, so whichever reasons. But yes, we're aware of these types of diets. We really very much work at the population level. So, I mean, we can include some of these within our search terms, but they wouldn't routinely be picked up in the monitoring that we were talking about. It's not something that I'd really been top of our list in terms of, you know, tracking, but it is something that we could include going forward.
Because that does fly in the face of the evidence of saying eat less red meat if you're getting your nutrients from red meat. And then also counteracts this point about heavily processed food.
Yeah, I mean, I think what we'd need to work out is what the sort of numbers are in terms of the proportion of the population, because even the proportion of vegan consumers within Scotland is very, very, very small. So we really look at the majority rather than some of these more niche, if you like. And so our advice is really for only high consumers to cut back, just to reiterate that. It's not necessarily for everyone to cut down. And these sorts of diets can be quite... they're not necessarily following a healthy balanced diet, as you allude to there, so we need to make sure that that's the message that we're getting across, rather than just these very niche and specific pieces. But as you say, if they become more predominant, then we will certainly be having make sure that they're on our radar.
Thank you.
Thanks. Ivan McKee.
Yeah, thank you. Morning, still morning. Just a couple of brief points. One was around the Good Food Nation plan and the targets within that, and just to get a perspective from you on how effective you think that is in tackling both the dietary challenges but also climate targets as well.
I can start on this. I think we welcome the Good Food Nation plan. I think anything that makes clarity that we have ambitions for Scotland to eat more healthily and in line with our Eat Well guide is strongly welcome. And I think Scotland's got a very good food history to be proud of and should promote. I think in particular in relation to the plan is out, it's good to have a baseline. It's good to actually see what we've got in progress and what we need to follow through on. I think that there is room for clearer connection between the outcomes that we're seeking and for the objectives that are there and the actions that we're going to take. I think at the moment some of those linkages between the actions and the intended outcome are a little bit loose. So I think we need to maybe do a little bit more tightening up on results. Where are the results going to come from? For example, yes, strongly welcome a lot of the actions that are ongoing, but will they actually lead to that desired outcomes in the long term? I think that needs to be tightened up quite a bit. But it is the first iteration. It's out for consultation at the moment, and we'll be continuing to work with government and other partners to try and make that linkage a little bit closer. Okay. But for example, the child payment is in there as an action. That's excellent. Everybody welcomes the approach to tackle poverty in children. What I'd like to see is something a little bit more that says, well, how does that money get directed to improving childhood health through improved public health nutrition?
OK, that's helpful. Thanks. OK. And the other question was round about the roles and responsibilities of yourselves, Food Standards Scotland and the Scottish Food Commission. I know this is an issue that's been raised before, so what your perspective on that is and where discussions are round about that clarification.
I think now that the chair post has been advertised, it's a good time for us to sit down and actually clarify. So we have made approaches to various parties in government just to say that clarity of where does our role stop and where does Scottish Food Commission start. There is that paragraph within the Good Food Nation plan about them being focused on the actual plans from the local authorities and health boards. But I think it does, to get that, Gillian talked earlier about how we need to make sure that all the contributions add up to get the kind of influence that we need. And I think we need to sit down together and work out where those lines sit, who's responsible for what. So at the moment, we have a huge focus on industry, retail, etc., trying to ensure that the food environment improves. And I think that could be something where because the plans that Scottish Food Commission are looking at are more in the public sector domain, that that interface between our role with industry and the public sector role that's looking at Good Food Nation, that that might be somewhere where we could meet and not overlap. But we need to do those conversations, and probably sooner rather than later, given that the chair's job description's out at the moment.
Good. Thank you very much. Good.
Thanks. So we've already touched a bit on the Eat Well Everyday Meal Plan. So I suppose I'm keen to know how FSS are measuring people's engagement with that resource, what tools you're using for that.
Happy to come in. So I think there's two separate things, and they all sound very similar. So there's the Eat Well Every Day, which is a menu over a week. We have one, but we use that for a lot of things in terms of looking at the amount of meat that's in that diet and other things. The amount of consumers that are engaging with it, I don't think that's huge at the moment. That when we're overhauling our new website, that's something that we're certainly looking at. Because we also have a health eating tutorial, so that's helpful for those that want to upskill and know a bit more about nutrition. Again, I think it's underutilised, so we've got some opportunities there. We also have, as Heather mentioned, Eat Well Your Way. Just got that right. So, and that helps consumers when they want to make some changes in the diet. It looks at the motivations, actions, and prompts, and so it's got some behavioural techniques behind it, so that it can be smaller things but more sustainable over time. So that's the main consumer-facing piece. And again, we had a campaign, and we don't have money for that anymore, and there was a lot of traffic to the website at that point. So that hasn't been sustained, but we are keeping a track on it. And with the overhaul of the new website, that's going to change how it's positioned and hopefully integrate it and drive more traffic there. Because we do know that certainly the nutrition pages in the five food groups are very well visited, I think. So it's kind of how we then utilise some of the traffic that goes there. We do analyse that, and the traffic that does result to be on those pages, they do tend to stay. So it's quite good, the information that we've got, but we need to just get more people visiting it. And we have done some work with health professionals to try and see if that might be something that they'd be keen to work with when they're working with community groups and other people. So we are looking into ways to try and address that. But I think there are, as you point out, there's some underutilised bits of the website. The Eat Well Everyday piece, we've looked at that menu also to try and cost it in terms of how much does that cost in terms of, for achieving a healthy balanced diet, looking at comparing that with what people spend. And actually, the averages, the figures are kind of similar. So what people spend, you could actually, in theory, have a healthy diet. But, you know, these are averages. So there's a lot of people with spending a lot more and a lot of people spending a lot less. So it's not just about how much money you have. It's that social environment and in facilitating, making things easier for people to purchase and have a healthy diet. And there's so many more factors, social factors, that need to be looked at that often sit out with our remit, mm-hmm. to be honest, but that we work with others to try and move those agendas on.
I think it would be helpful to see what the figures are in terms of visits, if you would be able to write to
we
committee. And then it gives us a baseline for once you've refreshed your website to look and see has that visitor traffic increased. Emma Harper.
Thanks, convener. Just looking at the Food Standards Scotland website, you've got the Eat Well Guide in British Sign Language as well. There's a wee video about that, so that's actually probably worth us sharing on our social media. A quick question about food crime. It's another issue that people seem to be unaware of, the work that Food Standards Scotland does around food crime, which is really important. And it might be that we need to get more info by writing to you, because I know time is a bit tight. So I'd be interested to just hear a quick note about the food crime prevention strategy and what does that mean. And also, there's I know we haven't even really talked about food for cattle or how that works as far as Food Standards Scotland's role in regulation and monitoring of feed for our animals that then end up in our food supply chain. But food crime is probably something that you probably expect to be asked about, so happy to hear about that.
I'll try and be brief. So basically the team that we've got dealing with food crime also deals with incident management, and so we've got incident management, intelligence and investigation are all under one particular unit. And it came about after the horse meat incident in 2013, when we were setting up in 2015. It was one of the things we put some priority into. The part of the challenge at the moment, which is that food law itself doesn't really tackle this very well. So we're having to use common law, and we're working with the Crown Office and other authorities. For example, there's about 18 enforcement authorities at which we sit on. In terms of prevention, we use the National Intelligence Model as the basis of our operation, because it's something that all enforcement communities understand. And the kind of deterrence and prevention is actually very much, if you like, the kind of criminal sanction in terms of taking people to court is the kind of end of the process. And if we can do things that stop and disrupt in the first place, then that's what we'll do. We have also introduced recently a kind of food crime risk assessment tool that businesses can use. So they kind of do a self-assessment themselves in terms of where they see the threats are to their supply chains and their production, which again is the idea of focusing on prevention. And then the other arm of it is we have run for a number of years now, I think we just did it this week actually or yesterday, things like lead poisoning of cattle on farm, and we've done a regular exercise on that because of the risks to the human health chain and obviously to the farmer's livelihood as well. So obviously it's not one of those things we talk about very much. I think it is worth stating though that, you know, the vast majority of people that are in the food sector are in it for the right reasons, not for the wrong ones. And I think, you know, in terms of you've kind of at the extreme end, you've got the serious organised crime. At the other end, you've got the regulatory crime. And then you've kind of got this fuzzy bit in the middle, which is around food fraud, authenticity, substitution. That's a bit more complicated to address. So we can provide more information, or if you wanted, we could do something a bit more private where we could share some more information than we would in a public forum. But it is an important area of focus for us because it's about actually protecting the reputation of Scotland. And certainly at an international level, we currently chair what's called the Global Alliance. We didn't call it that, but which is Australia, New Zealand, the States, Canada, and ourselves, the UK, as part of this shared approach in terms of techniques and approaches and sharing of information. And we also do a lot of horizon scanning and surveillance to just see where the threats are. And that includes things looking at climate factors. So a bad olive harvest, for example, will escalate potentially the scale of risk for adulteration of olive oil. So that's a very quick canter through food crime. On feed, again, very briefly, feed controls it's kind of split. We've kind of got responsibility for it. We do some of the direct delivery ourselves and we use local authorities to do it. It's a risk-based process. There are farm inspections. There are also third-party audits that also take place on feed premises as well. So, again, it's part of a risk-based approach to the food chain from end to end, really.
Yeah, that's great. Thanks. I know that we might have some further info that we might need to get from you in more detail, I suppose.
Thanks. And Sandish Gohani.
Thank you, Convener. I want to touch on things like meal replacement shakes, which I believe goes to a diet culture where a huge proportion, I was going to say most people, but I suspect it is, have been on a diet on and off for their entire lives. Do you think consumers feel that things like meal replacement shakes and other are healthy alternatives to eating well? And if you do, what have you done about it?
It's a very good question. And I think the answer is that we don't know if consumers think they're a healthy alternative. We've not actually asked that question. I think some of the ones where we are aware of these meal replacement shakes. It's for weight loss, and there are, you know, they're specifically designed, and there are programs for those with type 2 diabetes, for example, to use these types of very low calorie meal replacements in treatment of type 2 diabetes and weight reduction. These types of meal replacement shakes are more designed, I think, for the general public, and that's not something we certainly wouldn't recommend. We recommend a healthy, balanced diet, but I guess if consumers want to have these things, that's, they do sit within the existing food regulations in terms of labelling and safety, so we don't have concerns there. We wouldn't really necessarily advocate them at all, but I think it's not something we've actually asked a lot of questions about, and we don't have a lot of information about in terms of the general population. I do know that they are expected to increase in terms of sales, and so it is possibly something that we need to have more of an eye to. There is an inequalities piece here, because they are more marketed towards sort of those with higher incomes rather than those on the lower income. So we also have to be careful that we keep that in our sights as well.
But certainly looking at the perception of healthy foods versus what is healthy, things like cereal bars, a lot of people think they're a very healthy alternative to having breakfast, when in fact they're full of sugar and they're full of salts and other things. And there's a lot of foods which are perceived to be healthy, which are patently not. What research have you done looking at that and the public's perception of what is healthy?
Generally, we ask quite general questions, so we don't have very specifics. What we would have is advice around things like your front-of-pack labelling, around, because I think cereal bars or breakfast cereal are kind of almost the same kind of category, in that you can get really good extremes that are good ones and bad ones, and really you need to look at the label or the front of the, if it's on the front of pack, that's the best way to determine it. And people don't have time to necessarily do that, so we know that it's complicated for people. I think that's why things like this rebalancing these promotions is important, because if you can't promote those things, then they're less in the consumer's kind of psyche, if you like. So promoting those that are the healthier range of the spectrums is one way to kind of look at it. We haven't specifically looked at these questions. As I say, it's more general kind of questions around healthy diet, and when we model our healthy diet on the Eat Well Every Day, it's even quite hard to fit any of these types of things in. You have to have very low sugar cereals, you have to have things like plain porridge. That's how you're going to have a healthy breakfast, and there's not a lot of scope in terms of for sugar, particularly for some of these in a healthy diet. So if people want to look at that, it gives you a good idea of how difficult it is to actually, you can fit some of them in, but only in small amounts, and so a sugary cereal bar is going to contribute quite a lot to your sugar intake. So
I think just very quickly, I think there's lots and lots of people looking for the quick fix to the kind of dietary challenges. I think that's part of the issue, to be honest. You know, how can I lose X amount of calories in the next 3 weeks sort of philosophy. Yeah, and at the most strategic level, you kind of got this basic thing about energy in and energy out, and you've got the whole micronutrient issues around everything around diet as well. And I think this goes back to the broader question around kind of consumer education and understanding, really, around diet and how the body works, metabolism, all those sorts of things are all part and parcel of that. How do you actually move towards a healthier nation? Because, you know, we've got 67% of the population are overweight and obese. At some point, we have got to be really serious about how we actually reverse that trend, because if we keep going, it's just getting worse and worse and worse. So I think there is a broader contextual piece, I think, around what that basic understanding is of how we consume, what we consume, and our the way the body then uses that energy it's provided with. And that does come down a little bit to that kind of personal responsibility, but it's not solely the exercise more, eat less is the answer. Because it goes back to the other points I made around the overall food environment. How do you actually make it easier for people to make the right choices, I think, is a critical question as well.
I mean, certainly that was, we had a long discussion about that earlier. My final question, and I know time's against us, I was on your website, I was looking at your X, and you've got 6,000 followers, or maybe less than that. So you know, that's certainly something that can be improved. But I didn't see anything about portions, because our plates have gone from what is essentially a side plate into something which used to be a serving plate. And so portion control is possibly one of the most important ways of a healthy, balanced diet that allows calorie control and allows us to think about what we're doing. And you know, hands are a great way of doing that. Do you have any thoughts upon that and how to promote that?
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting because some of the answers to this have been around for a long time. So I think the McKinsey report 2009, was it? 2006 or 2009, kind of came up with five answers to the diet. You know, reformulation was in there, portion size was in there, taxation was in there. So it's not the answers aren't around. They've been around for quite a while. I suppose it's just the difficulty with diet is there isn't actually any one simple answer to the problem. So you're absolutely right, portion size is an issue. Are portions too big? Yes, generally. And it's interesting, we did some a campaign a couple of years ago now around the kind of the upgrade in the fast food restaurant, you know, pay an extra 50p for the large portion of fries. And we did some evaluation of that, and it did actually show that you, with the right focus, you could actually change behaviours, and people did actually move away from that kind of larger portion size. But yeah, portion control is key, but reformulation is key. Our view is taxation, levies is key, and you need all of those, I think, all of those levers.
I think that's absolutely right. There's no one thing that'll do it. And just to sort of emphasise what you said there, Jeff, I think the out-of-home food environment, and that's where we know the portions are much significantly greater than the retail. And it's harder to know what's happening in the house, and our Intake 24 survey will help to shed some light on that. But I think the out-of-home food industry, we know 25% of calories are coming from there, and we know they tend to be larger portions and more energy dense. So that's where we need to make sure that we can kind of try and see how we can address that in the future.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can I thank the witnesses for their attendance this morning? Next week, the committee will not be meeting, as we'll be undertaking external engagement in Skye as part of the committee's inquiry into healthcare in remote and rural areas. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today.